Hi everybody, Dr. A here. In this second video on microbiology basics, we are going to look at the development of an infection. So there are six elements that are involved in the development of infections. The first element is the infectious agent itself. So questions we can ask is, for example, how pathogenic is it, or how likely it is to cause disease? Something that's really pathogenic will cause disease even in a healthy person, okay? So if you're exposed, even though you're healthy, you will get sick. Something that is not very pathogenic, it may require a certain dose of the microbe, or it may require that the, you know, host is maybe sickly or something like that, or before it sets up infection. And so pathogenicity, it refers to the ability of an organism to cause disease. And that is directly a reflection of the organism's virulence or disease-causing potential. So high virulence means high ability to cause disease. Okay. Malaria, for example, has high virulence. If you get bit by a mosquito that has malaria, unless you have a specific protective antigen on your red cells, you're going to get malaria, okay? Not everybody gets the common cold. And some strains of the cold might be more virulent than others, right? So next is, within the infectious agent, is you have to ask, how susceptible is this infection or this organism to treatment, okay? So pathogens or infectious agents have different mechanisms of escaping destruction because they have set up home in your body and they want to stay there, okay? So some could produce a slimy capsule which inhibits phagocytosis. So phagocytosis is eating of the bacteria by the white cells. So it can, maybe the white cell either can't eat it, or if it eats it, it can't like break it down and destroy it. So an example of an organism that produces a slimy capsule is Streptococcus pneumoniae. Other organisms can secrete toxic byproducts, and then those can cause problems with treatment and cause symptoms and stuff. So Corynebacterium diphtheriae is one of them. And others can invade the cells and hide in existing inside as intracellular parasites. So they can hide inside the white cells, or can hide like viruses inside the body cells, which then of course makes it a little bit harder to get to them, because basically for viruses, once they're inside the cell, the whole cell has to be destroyed in order to destroy the viruses. So for example, Mycobacterium TB can hide inside the white cells, but then the white cell can't destroy it. So then the white cell becomes a little harbor for TB. Again, viruses are always intracellular parasites. So they, whenever they can, they get into the cells. But of course, in between, they're in transit and they're floating around in the bloodstream or in the fluids. And then Plasmodium falciparum is the organism that causes malaria. And it has to get inside of the red cells to cause problems. And that's also how it evades treatment. Then, of course, you have to ask how many organisms are required to initiate the infection. So does it require just a few organisms, or does it require really a big dose, like millions, right? So at least 107 colony-forming units of the quail strain of Salmonella is needed to produce typhoid fever. But only 10 to 50 organisms, so that's single little bacteria, of Francisella tularensis are required to cause tularemia. And for cholera, it's more like a million organisms in water is required to cause cholera. And so does it require a lot or just a little bit? So if it requires a lot and you only got a small dose, then it's possible the you don't get an infection, right? And if it just requires a little bit and you got a big dose, then you could get a really bad infection. The second element is going to be the reservoir. So a reservoir is an area where the organism can grow and flourish, and they're often a source of infection. So anything can act as a reservoir. For example, shellfish can host Vibrio cholera, so can contaminated water. Ticks can harbor Rickettsia rickettsii, which causes Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Soil and feces can be contaminated with Clostridium tetani, which causes tetanus, and Clostridium tetani produces a toxin, and that's what gives you the symptoms of tetanus. This is the one, if you step on a rusty nail that's contaminated with soil that could have Clostridium tetani, you want to, you know, when you get a bad wound, you want to go get a tetanus shot, because it's possible if soil got into that deep wound that you could get infected with this bacteria. And then, of course, water can harbor all kinds of organisms, especially parasites, but also bacteria like Legionella and Pneumophila, which was in like the air conditioning systems and the mist coming off from the air conditioning system in a hotel. During the Legionnaires convention, they made a bunch of people sick with pneumonia, and that's where it got its name. So anything can act as a reservoir, including the human body. So the human body can be a reservoir for certain infections. So the respiratory tract can become the reservoir for Mycobacterium tuberculosis for patients that have TB. So then they're a walking reservoir of TB, and whenever they cough, they're sending the bacteria out, and they could cause infection in other patients or other people. The mouth can contain Streptococcus viridans. It's pretty normal, like it can be in there, especially if the person doesn't have good oral hygiene. The vagina could harbor Neisseria gonorrhea or Chlamydia trachomatis. And so both of those could be what we call a silent infection in a person. So they have it, they have no idea. And if they haven't protected sex with another person, then they can transmit the infection. The colon can harbor Salmonella typhi, and cause Salmonella infection. The urethra can harbor Trichomonas vaginalis, another sexually transmitted infection. Again, can be silent in some patients or some people, so they don't know they have it. And the skin could harbor Staphylococcus epidermidis, which is normally just completely harmless, but if it gets like pushed into the body or into the bloodstream, it can cause problems. Next, the third element is the portals of exits from the reservoir, from the patient itself, if the patient is a reservoir. So skin or mucous membranes can provide a means of exits for Staphylococcus aureus, which produces a yellow discharge from the nose, and also from a skin wound, right? Would have a yellow discharge. Pseudomonas aeruginosa will produce a green discharge. The respiratory tract, through sneezing, coughing, talking, this is one of the things we were trying to address with the masking with coronavirus, was to try to limit the portal of exit that the respiratory tract was for the coronavirus. But I mean, it's the respiratory tract is definitely the portal of exit for many things, especially common cold viruses, flu, etc. The urinary tract, even though urine is normally sterile, if it's contaminated, if there's an infection, then the bacteria can exit through urination or through catheterization. And the GI tract, so the oral cavity and intestines contain a high number of bacteria. And so a portal of exit would be through saliva, for example. It sounds silly, but if somebody bit somebody else, like those bacteria from the mouth can get into deep into the tissue and cause all kinds of problems. Feces, you think, well, people don't play with poop. Well, yeah, but if they don't wash their hands properly after using the bathroom, then it could have traces of feces on their hands, not knowing. And then if they go handle food, then that can contaminate the food and then eat that. And anyway, so that's a portal of exit, maybe feces. And then vomitus, obviously, if it's due to an infection or something, and whether it's viral or bacterial, and vomiting to vomit can be contaminated also, and a portal of exit for the infection. The reproductive tract can be a portal of exits through urethral discharge, vaginal secretions, urine, and semen. So that would be how sexually transmitted diseases are spread. And the blood, which is normally sterile, through breaks in the skin, traumatic wounds, or needle punctures. All of those can cause the infective agent to be able to leave the site. The fourth element is going to be transmission. So the mode of transmission, there are numerous modes of transmission available. So almost any object, living or inert, could transmit a disease. So a living object could be your hands, right? So if your hands are contaminated, and then you go to shake somebody's hands and you didn't, you know, use any hand sanitizer or wash them recently, you could transmit a virus or something to another person. But the same thing, if you have contaminated hands and you touch a doorknob, and then the next person that touches the same doorknob could pick up whatever was contaminating your hands, virus, you know, bacteria and stuff. So some specific diseases could require specific transmission routes, such as malaria is spread by mosquitoes, West Nile virus is spread by mosquitoes, venereal diseases or sexually transmitted infections are transmitted via sexual or intimate contact. So the different transmission modes include contact, which is person to person, but it can also be person to person, like via an inanimate object also. Then there's air. So that's through breathing particles of air. So through, again, coughing something out and it's in the air, and then you breathe that air with the bacteria in there, sneezing, anything that aerosolizes what could have been coming from the respiratory tract is air or airborne transmission. Dust, especially if dust is disrupted, and so especially if it's contaminated with rodent feces, like with hantavirus, then you disturb that dust and stuff and breathe it in, and it can transmit hantavirus that way. Food and water that's contaminated. So again, if somebody had contaminated hands and handled food, then that food would be contaminated, but you may not know because it just has little traces of it there, and then you eat and you end up with hepatitis A or with salmonella or something. And then water that's contaminated. Insects, so again, ticks, mosquitoes, any kind of biting bugs, and then animals can be reservoirs. They can harbor certain organisms, and then they can transmit them also. So through an animal bite or handling of the animal feces, etc. And so that's with things that are transmitted from animals are referred to as zoonoses. The fifth element is a portal of entry into a new host. They are the same as a portal of exits from the reservoir. And so they'll be the skin and mucous membranes. So, for example, that's for a lot of like flu, coronavirus, and all of that. If your hands are contaminated and then you touch your nose or touch your eyes or mouth, or even those, you could, you know, get the infection transmitted that way. Through the respiratory tract, so that would be through breathing in those contaminated air droplets and stuff, so that's how it would go in. Through the urinary tract, so, you know, maybe if bacteria got into the opening of the urinary tract and that bacteria is motile, they can climb up and get into the bladder. Through the GI tract, it's usually going to be through eating something that's contaminated, and then it gets into the GI tract. Reproductive tract, again, sexually transmitted from one person to the other. And then through contaminated blood. That would be also like using a dirty needle or a contaminated needle or something, poking it into the a vein. That would be a direct entry into the bloodstream. And then lastly, the sixth element is a susceptible host. So susceptibility is dependent upon the degree of resistance of the host. So how healthy is the host? If you're healthy and you have good nutrition and, good stress management and all that, most people are pretty resistant to infections. Of course, the more virulent the pathogen is, the more likely the host will be susceptible to it, it will cause infection even in a healthy individual that's not normally susceptible to a lot of infections. So the factors that can affect susceptibility to infections are age, meaning our younger ones that have an immature immune system, so our infants, and then our older ones who have an immune system that might be degrading are going to be more susceptible. Nutrition is a big factor. So somebody that lacks enough vitamin D or vitamin A or vitamin C, those are all very important for the immune system to operate properly, and they can be more likely to get the disease. So for example, we've even seen with coronavirus, the people that were deficient in vitamin D were more likely to get the severe forms of the COVID. And stress, people that are under stress are more likely to get sick because the body's having to divert energy to stress versus to the immune system to fight off the infection. And so, and stress just makes you immunocompromised anyway. So anyway, that is the last and sixth one. So we got one more video on microbiology basics. So I'll see you there.